Apology Tournament with me, Cam Leslie, and Sottle. And a change to the schedule. We're going to bring you a different match now. We're going to skip ahead. We're going to come back to Orange versus Trifecro later on. We're actually going to bring you another completely stacked matchup. It's going to be Dog versus Zelay, two of the very best players in North America. So, you know, we talked in the last couple of matches having to introduce people who maybe players, fans didn't know so much about, people watching maybe hadn't heard of Jordud or Ryzen, but I don't think that's the case with these two.
Yeah, I don't think there's too much danger of that. Dog, for sure, one of the biggest names in Hearthstone at this point. He's really taken off in every aspect that he possibly can. Picked up a bunch of impressive tournament performances. He's also one of the biggest streamers in Hearthstone now, consistently getting into that five-figure bracket where he's breaking 10,000 quite commonly. Zelay, probably a little bracket below that, but everyone still knows what's up with Zelay. Still a big streamer in his own right. Popular Deck Doctor series, which picked up a lot of traction for him.
Also his swimming streams.
Right. But I guess the one thing missing for him is the big breakout tournament performance. He made a big splash initially when we first saw him in the ESL Legendary series, where he did very well. But beyond that, you know, he's had some reasonable results where he's got deep into a few tournaments. But unless you're going to correct me, Callum, I don't believe there's any huge results in his resume at this point.
Well, he does have a couple of wins. He has the WCA Americas qualifier.
Right.
Where he managed to beat Trump and Hyped in order to qualify for that. And I think he beat Firebat and Amaz to win that. So he won... I think it was a $5,000 prize pool, and he won the BlackRock Mountain Launch Invitational.
Ah.
That weird Amazon tournament.
I don't think I ever saw that, actually.
Yeah, well, funnily enough, Saul, in the first round of that tournament, you know who he beat 3-2? Funnily enough, it was Mr. Dog. So
good. I knew there was a reason we had you here, Callum. I knew there was a reason.
Well, you know, I can look at Liquipedia like with the best of them.
Yeah.
We also beat Hyped and RDU 3-0 in that tournament. So that was a strong showing for him. And I remember the last time we casted Zelay, I think got top 4 the HS Arena Invitational.
Right.
And that was having not known that it was last year standing.
Yeah.
He prepared a lineup for Conquest and still got top 4 in the last year standing tournament.
Yeah.
So hopefully he knows what the format is this time.
Yep, for sure. I hope he knows he's going into an LHS tournament here. But yeah, those sort of top 4s, top 8s, those are the performances that I'm used to seeing from Zelay. And again, we talked about consistency with Kranich previously. And I think that sort of consistency from Zelay to keep showing up in these tournaments and, you know, keep putting on solid performances shows his quality of a player. But he just hasn't had that extra edge so far to really make a big splash and get up to the level of success that we've seen Dog have over the past year or so.
Yeah, I mean, Dog has one win to his name, but it was a team win, the CN versus NA Gold Series Challenge, which I casted with D2, with him and him, Firebat, VLPS, Death Star, and Teray.
Yes.
Beats a star Chinese lineup, Teray, a blast from the past there. Talking about the 2014 World Championships earlier. He does have a number of second places, including the DreamHack Summer 2015 Swiss Tournament.
Yep.
Yeah, he has also kind of yet to have a signature win, and that's really what you need to be a high-level player, right? To be one of those really breakthrough players, you need that signature win. Obviously, it works for the World Championships, but when you think of RDU, you think of DreamHack Summer 2014.
Yeah.
And that really breakthrough performance. You think of Orange, you think of when he was able to string together the win in Katowice and at Seat Story Cup, the double majors back-to-back, Hoi at Viagame House Cup. You need to win a tournament. And, you know, this might not necessarily be the tournament that can be a signature win, but when you start building these up, we saw that with Life Coach, that he was able to put together a number of online tournament wins, which led to him being able to win a major tournament. I believe he won the Viagame House Cup in Romania, right?
Yes, yeah, I believe he did, yeah.
So yeah, so it's all about momentum and it's all about building that up. So we do have the class lineups for you, if we can get them in just a second, but I can tell you we have the bans as well. So for Dog, he brought Warrior, Druid, Rogue, and Warlock. Dog, another very experienced Rogue player, very high-level Rogue player. And Zelay bringing Warrior, Druid, Mage, and Warlock. So very similar lineups. Dog ended up banning the Druid, and Zelay banned the Warrior. So it's going to be the Druid Rogue Warlock versus the Warrior Mage Warlock.
Yeah, interesting stuff. So Dog chose to ban out the Druid here, which suggests he's playing a fairly controlly lineup. Maybe the Warlock is not the Zoo, more of a control variant with the Reno. I know Dog on stream has a tendency to play some experimental decks, should we say. We have the Battlecry Mage that he's got reasonably popular with recently, also known as Concede Mage, because it just makes your opponent want to concede.
Chariots to Exploding Cow, the pioneer of Concede Mage.
Yeah, very, very similar type of deck, just completely resource-based, starve your opponent, get rid of all their stuff, very much along those lines. We've also seen him experimenting with various different versions of Control Warrior, all the way along the curve to the really heavy Fatigue Warrior variants. He's even been experimenting with Molten Giant's Charge and nonsense stuff like that, so... has this tendency to really, like, experiment, but usually when you see him in a tournament, he goes back to the more consistent stuff, but maybe there's a little wrinkle in here somewhere, and he's brought something a little bit out of left field.
Yeah, we're just getting these players ready. Obviously, we moved the schedule up a little bit, so we're just getting these players together, and they're getting themselves ready, because, you know, you have to do all your preparations and your rituals to play. Do you have any superstitions when you play Hearthstone, Subtle?
I don't. Apart from the superstition that every random effect in the game is going to go against me, that's about the only one that I hold.
I remember when you and I were working at the Gfinity Summer Masters tournament, the weirdest one of those weird pre-match rituals or sort of ticks that a player had while playing match was Filey and his paper. He used to take paper into the booth, not to write, but to tear into little squares.
Oh, yeah,
Tearing little squares of paper somehow relaxed him and got him into the mindset to play Hearthstone. Which, I don't know if either of these players have things like that. Maybe Zalee's had to go for a swim first. Maybe Dogs had to, I don't know, make sure there's enough Franker's spam in Twitch chat.
Just watching your brain search for a dog pun there and then bail out immediately at the end. That was awesome.
No puns here.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, so just trying to find out what the slight delay is. Obviously, we'll get into this match as quickly as possible. We know you guys are not here to look at us. You're here to watch the games and listen to us ruin them as minimally as possible.
That you've pretty much just described casting there, Callum.
That is how casting works.
Yeah, pretty much.
So the winner of Dog versus Ali, of course, will advance to the top 8 tomorrow, and they will have another really interesting contest on their hands at Wehoy versus Jab. The winner of that will face the winner of this Dog and Zalee matchup. I do really like the NA versus EU aspect we've got to quite a lot of these matchups. We have obviously Orange versus Strifecrow, Hoi versus Jab, and Life Coach versus Purple, because you don't always necessarily get to see EU players and NA players, the very best, compete in the same tournament. You might get, you know, one or two NA players and a mostly EU tournament, or vice versa.
Yeah, it's very true. Of course, the NA versus EU rivalry is something that is rampant throughout Hearthstone and everyone...
Through esports,
sure. But it's something that everyone likes to have their input on. Personally, I'm not a particularly nationalistic or continentalistic, whatever the word is for that particular connotation. But sure, just to rile up some Americans, I guess it's worth taking some EU pride and things, right?
Well, you know, I mean, NA sucks at most esports, so they're just about good enough at Hearthstone. And, you know, if we're talking about something like Counter-Strike, well, NA, you know, it's not worth talking about, to be honest. But here in Hearthstone, the North American players can compete, and they do have some of the very best players, and we'll see that here. There we go, we can see the players are ready. We have the lineups there, as described before, just to recap them for you.
Yeah, so Dog is bringing Warrior, Druid, Rogue, and Warlock, and his Warrior is banned. And Zalee is bringing Warrior, Mage, Warlock, and Druid, and his Druid is banned. So we talked a little bit about the Druid ban, but I wonder why Zalee has chosen to ban Warrior here. It's not a common ban to ban out Warrior particularly. What do you think? There's anything particularly you might be scared of here?
I mean, the obvious ones are if you think Dog's going to play Control Warrior then, and you're playing Patron, that's a decent ban. But also just if you're playing Freeze Mage.
Yeah, then... Freeze Mage is the big flag, right? So I would suggest that Mage is probably a Freeze Mage from him. But at the same time, he does have that Druid that he can immediately come back and counter. But we see that has got banned out. So Maybe he was just predicting the druid getting banned and needed to react to that with the warrior, or there was just too much potential for the warrior to pick up free wins, but looks like he's trying to line up a situation where that mage potentially tries to pick up one more win, but he has left the druid standing in his opponent's lineup, so it seems unlikely that that freeze mage will be able to pick up more than one win either way.
Alright, so looks like some version of control warlock for Dog here. More than likely Arena Lock, but a lot of elements of Handlock there. We saw the Twilight Drake and the Jiraxis. And it does look like Patron Warrior for Zalae.
Yep. So
we're getting to see a Patron.
Yeah, we're getting to see this Patron Warrior versus Reno Lock matchup again. And this time it is the more control variant. This is the variant that I had the discussion with Trump about, where he was playing a Void Caller list with Bran Healbot and, you know, all the kind of extra late game demons, the Mal'Ganis, the Jiraxis, all that stuff. So this is the matchup that Trump feels is very, very heavily favored to the Reno Lock. I think the Patron has a pretty reasonable chance in. But Dog's early mulligan here, he's going to be probably quite passive for the opening turns. He has a very handlocky opening with a tap into Drake or Void Caller. I guess there is the potential for this to still just be handlock as well with the Bran in it.
There is, as we discussed before, handlock is quite out of favor right now. Why do you think it is that handlock is so unpopular?
I mean, I don't think there's anything particularly wrong with handlock. It's just that it's been supplanted as a control warlock deck by Reno Lock. Like, the effect of Reno is just too good to pass up. And since the level of suffering that you get from having 30 individual cards in your deck isn't as severe as everyone thought it was going to be initially, it seems like just playing Reno Lock is a more secure option, because if you draw Reno, you're so favored in so many aggro matchups that you kind of wipe those off the board anyway, and then the Warlock hero power just takes care of all the control matchups. But there is nothing wrong with Handlock. Like, the abusive mechanics in Handlock to discount giants, play Molten Giants, Mountain Giants, etc. for cheap, like, that mechanic is too powerful to write the deck off. So I don't think it's a deck that will ever go away unless we see some sort of adjustment to some of the cards like Molten Giant in the new set. I don't think it's too big of an issue. Doomguard comes into hand here from Dog, so...
Yeah, we did talk about Fibonacci just bringing Demon Handlock. This kind of looks like Demon Handlock, right?
It really does, right? We haven't seen any duplicates yet, so we can't be sure, but definitely seems to be going down the line of Demon Handlock here, but still could lean either way.
This is the thing, I mean, you can also build... You can build Reno decks in a number of different ways. You can build them just with putting good cards in around Reno, but you can also take something like Handlock or Demon Handlock, take out all the duplicates, and just replace them.
Right.
It's another way to build those decks. So it could just be he's playing a version that is Demon Handlock with all the duplicates replaced, and he happens to have drawn all the Demon Handlock cards.
Yep. For sure. But this is one of the strong openings for Patron Warrior in this matchup, for sure. Gets to hide.
There is a duplicate.
There is a duplicate. So it looks like this is just Demon Handlock, in fact. So again, we talked about matchups before where Patron may have benefited a little bit from the change. I think this is actually another one where, you know, being able to tempo out early with some more minions in your deck is a little bit stronger against Handlock than just saving up for the Wombo combo is, because Handlock has so many ways to effectively play around that. So this is another matchup that's probably benefited a little bit by the new mid-range build and the Warsong nerf, but still probably a favored matchup over for Handlock overall, because the heal back to full of the Reno is usually not a big deal in this matchup. What you have to worry about is being able to clear your opponent's boards, and Handlock is much more consistent at doing that because they play the double copies of the cards that you want, which is either Hellfire or Shadowflame. The extra AoE that the Reno Lock puts in, the Demon Wrath, is usually not effective in the matchup.
Do you think that predicting a lot of Patron in the meta might be part of the motivation for Dog maybe going back to a Handlock as opposed to a Reno Lock?
It could be. It's definitely a possibility, but I think Dog also just has this propensity to play things a little bit different. He's one of those Gaara-style players, I guess, that doesn't just always want to bring that standard stuff to the tournament. He does tend to put a little wrinkle in things here and there. Like I said, more so on his stream, he does tend to default back to type a little bit more in tournament, but maybe he's just inspired by the success of Fibonacci's Demon Handlock in the qualifiers and just decided it's a good deck again.
Well, he did get qualified for the America's Winter Championship, so it's, did serve him well. And the punish here with the Doomguard, no way to deal with it for Zalae.
No, no execute in hand, no big game hunter either, which is sometimes teched into this deck. So interesting that he was willing to risk the Mal'Ganis pull there, but I guess he just decided to call the bluff, didn't think that it was going to be that bad. But apart from Mal'Ganis, Doomguard is about as bad as it gets.
Yeah, I would say Doomguard. It depends. When you're the one activating it, I think Doomguard probably Dread Infernal, it's negligible. Obviously, the charge is much better, but Dog gets a Faceless Manipulator. And Faceless Manipulates the Doomguard. Don't mind that in the slightest.
I mean, we'll just load up on 5/5s right now. A 5/5 and a 5/6, in fact. Goes ahead and clears the board, and now his board is spread wider. It doesn't just die to a single execute anymore. The Deathbite is going to have to come in and take one of these out. So he's in a pretty good position here, especially since we don't see the execute in Zalae's hand.
And this, so the Faceless suggests there's some sort of combo in this deck as well. So you're looking at Demon Handlock, a very old school version of Demon Handlock with the combo.
It's possible, but if you're going to put Faceless in any deck as a value card, Handlock is the deck that you put it in.
Right.
Because there's just so many high value targets that you can copy. You know, you can just copy a 4/9 Drake, you can get two 8/8s on the board for zero mana if you just have one Molten Giant and a Faceless in your hand and you're down low, so... Faceless as a utility card, just for an extra threat in Handlock, is definitely valid.
That's why that combo was originally so popular, right? Because the Faceless, yeah. You know, the Faceless Leroy combo was great, but you could also just use Faceless really well to make two giants on the board when your opponent had no answer.
Exactly. Yeah.
So if you played one giant and your opponent didn't deal with it, it pretty much telegraphs they don't have an answer. So if you copy a second one, you're in a decent position.
Exactly. So, pretty reasonable hand building up here for Dog. He has the extra threat here with the Twilight Drake and now the Voidcaller that he can try and draw into another demon for. He has plenty of sustain cards with the Defenders of Argus and the Bran Heelbot combination. He's just missing maybe one or two removals in his hand to deal with the backswing explosion of patrons if it comes out. But otherwise, his looks like he's ready to keep going for a few turns with this hand, plus the additional cards that he'll pick up from the hero power.
Yeah, those things like Shadow Flame and Hellfire, the things we've really not seen so far from Dog's deck. Obviously, we've not seen a huge amount of it, but we've seen a lot of minions and not necessarily those AoE spells that he's potentially going to need to deal with Patron.
Yeah, when you're playing the demon variant of Handlock, you need to make room for the Void Callers and the extra demons. There's a few ways you can go about that. You can choose to cut the Mountain Giants to make room for the Void Callers. That's a line that a lot of players go down. But you can also cut back on the AoEs and just play one copy of Hellfire, one copy of Shadow Flame, and then look at cutting additional cards like Ancient Watchers, maybe one Mortal Coil, maybe one Dark Bomb. There's a lot of flexibility as to how you go about building it, but we'll just have to wait and see what comes out Dog's deck here on a card-by-card basis.
Ooh.
That Patient Assassin, though.
That potentially changes things. I mean, it deals with the Twilight Drake very well, but also... could cause a problem. I mean, the double Armorsmith Patient Assassin. Is there any board with less power that's more threatening?
Yeah, that's a very good question. In terms of a very, very low stat line board, this is very frustrating to deal with. He has some options, maybe try and just put up a Taunt minion here, use one of the Defenders of Argus just to protect the Twilight Drake. It looks like he's just going to go ahead and Argus here, which is...
Well, what could you... You would have to throw away the Bran, right?
You could Argus the Peddler.
Oh, that's true. Well, yeah, you can do the Peddler.
But, you know, you're pretty unconfident that that's going to stick, because there's a lot of options that end up dealing with that. You know, Fiery War Axe, Death Spite, etc. Slam plus the other Armorsmith that's going to stay alive. There's a lot of potential answers that make that not stick, so it doesn't seem like the... It seems like a very optimistic line to take. It looks like he's just going to play the Voidcaller out here, and this time the Voidcaller is a bluff, because we see no additional demon in hand.
We know there is a Jiraxxus in the deck.
Yes.
We haven't seen anything but Mal'Ganis, so there are other demons that could be pulled. Mm-hmm. So he's going to be thinking this time, maybe I won't just proc this, and actually... That's going to work out badly for him because the bluff is real this time.
Right, it's interesting because last time he seemed to just call the bluff. It was just, okay, that's a very, very early Voidcaller, so I'm just going to see what happens. There's a chance this is just a bluff. He was forced to develop it on turn 4 because he didn't have anything else. But yeah, so he called it the first time and got burned for it, so Like you said, it might just create the mentality that he doesn't want to deal with it this time. But this is the play that I talked about in a previous Patreon game where we watched, where, you know, the best turns for Frothing Berserker are either to get it down on the board early on turn three, or drop it down later on in combination with Lotheb so that it's really difficult to remove for your opponent.
Yep, and the perfect amount of mana to do so with the coin. So Zalae's starting to build a decent board here. And again, we haven't seen any kind of AoE from Dog yet.
No, so, I mean, just suggests, you know, purely based on statistics, that maybe one of the AoEs is something that he's cut from the deck to make room for the extra demons, and that's a pretty punishing prospect in this matchup where the AoEs are really your premium cards in the deck.
Well, he's actually going to do Brand Defender of Argus. I thought he was looking at perhaps the Brand Healbot, but he wants to deal with the board.
Yeah, Brand Healbot just doesn't really respond. You can still immediately take the amount of damage that you heal by leaving a Frothing Berserker up on the board with five or six minions in play, so he does need to kind of address the board right now. I think he probably accepts now that maybe his Void Caller is going to get called on this turn, but it's possible that both these minions just go into the Brand and the Void Caller is left alone. We still see no good answer in Zalae's hand if Mal'Ganis was to pop out of that, so...
Yeah, this is, it's kind of tough for Zalae, because as I said earlier, like, you know, he was clearly fine, he was happy to call the bluff last time, but now, having got burned the first time,
yeah,
is it going to be a little bit gun-shy in going for it a second time?
Yeah, I mean, it would, if there were a Mal'Ganis here, it would be so devastating for him, because there is just no strong answer in his hand. So it might just be a case of double trading into the Brand here and playing Dr. Boom, but that can potentially get blown out by many things. Something as simple as a Big Game Hunter means that the board is swung almost completely and the Handlock starts to develop a pretty imposing board state of their own.
We do see a Big Game Hunter in hand as well as a Mortal Coil.
Yep.
Which is going to be able to deal with this Lotheb. Lotheb.
And Lotheb of his own. But yeah, I think this turn always starts with the Mortal Coil. He'd love to dig through his deck, pick up another minion here, another demon, sorry. Draxxus or Mal'Ganis. Second Mortal Coil is fine too. There's plenty of good targets on the board for Mortal Coils right now.
So do you go for the second Mortal Coil before the BGH? I guess, well, you do, because you want to kill the boom. Yeah.
I'm not even sure that the second Mortal Coil does get cast here. He is going to go ahead and do it, but the concern is that you know, BGH plus a 5 drop this turn was looking pretty solid, and now by using that one additional mana, that isn't available to him anymore. So, picks up the Twilight Drake though, which fills out the mana perfectly now with the Big Game Hunter, so this looks pretty solid. And he's going to hope, I guess, that that Void Caller doesn't go down here. He doesn't want his bluff to get revealed. Of course, what am I thinking? It obviously takes out the Big Game Hunter.
That's how Bimbots work.
Yep.
Hits a random opponent, it's a random enemy unless your opponent has a Big Game Hunter.
Or an Azure Drake, which it will immediately hit before.
Oh, you've been hurt, haven't you?
I have, yeah. I've been burned one too many times.
Well, the bluff does get called with the War Axe.
Zalae, little look to one side there, like, oh, that went significantly better than expected.
He's gonna try and draw here. Gets another weapon, so, you know, we talked about too many weapons in hand for Eloise earlier on. I think having a weapon equipped with two in hand is also too many. But there's also a consideration, I guess. You've already hit with the Fiery War Axe, but you want to develop the Death Spike with respect to potentially hitting for lethal in the next couple of turns.
Yeah, I mean, that is a play you can make for sure if you feel like it's your only win condition, but you do literally have to feel like it's your only win condition because it's so painfully obvious what you're doing if you equip the Death Spike. That there's no way you're going to win by surprise that way. You'd literally have to have your opponent not have Taunt, not have healing in their hand. Zalae is going to pass it up.
When you know what you're playing against, you know there's a good chance there's healing and Taunt.
Right, exactly.
Because the deck usually runs at least five of those.
Yeah.
You're looking at, you know, double Sun Fury, single Argus, double Argus, single... Yeah.
Oh, the Blood Sail Corsair. Lovely.
That's the best Bloodsail Corsair I've ever seen. in a competitive match.
This situation comes up quite commonly, actually. I've seen some pretty nasty death spites get destroyed by Blood Cell Corsairs in patron matchups. It does come up every now and again. It's one of the hidden powers of Discover in that bad cards in Hearthstone are sometimes phenomenally good.
Cards you would never put in your deck.
Exactly.
At the time you play Discover are suddenly good.
Yeah, so Dark Peddler gives you that option of just having access sometimes to these cards like Corruption, like Blood Cell Corsair, like, I don't know, Voodoo Doctor, Tournament Attendee. All of these things can be really situationally useful, but you don't have to like put these awful cards in your deck. You can just rely, well, not rely, but hope that Dark Peddler is nice to you and gives them to you when you need them.
Well, Dog does get the win, and that's going to leave the Mage and the Warlock for Zelay. So the Handlock, I think there is also an element of surprise there, and you know, for Dog bringing that deck, which I definitely don't think Zelay would have expected to see.
No.
When you're playing in a tournament setting, how much does that throw you if you see something you're really not expecting?
It throws you. You go into your first pick and ban phase with a strategy in mind, so you kind of analyze what the decks are or what you expect them to be, what you think the relative percentages of which archetypes they're going to be are, and kind of build your initial strategy based on that. So if a deck comes out by surprise and catches you by surprise, then yeah, there is an element to it. But I think Dog does actually have a history of playing this deck in tournament. I don't think this is the first time we've seen it, so there's a possibility that Zelay does suspect that he's... did suspect that he would be seeing Demon Handlock from Dog, in which case it wouldn't have caught him by surprise at all. But if he was expecting maybe a Zoo, maybe a Reno Lock, then it could definitely throw a crimp in his works. But going back to his lineup now, the two decks he has remaining are Mage and...
Not Druid, he has Mage and Warlock.
He's picked the Mage, and we're suspicious that the Mage is a Freeze Mage.
Yeah, well, since he banned Warrior, it would make a lot of sense. Right. And we saw the Patron. So the Patron and Freeze Mage banning Warrior makes sense, because, you know, you can avoid a Patron Mirror. At worst, you avoid a Patron Mirror. At best, you avoid playing into Control Warrior.
Yeah.
And you avoid Freeze Mage versus Warrior. So it makes a lot of sense for the ban. We'll see in just a second. These guys are getting into the next game. Obviously, it's 1-0 to Dog here, and it's going to be the Demon Handlock of Warlock against whatever Mage it is that Zelay's brought. But we're going to go out on a limb and predict our second Freeze Mage of the day.
Yeah, it seems that way, yeah. I'd be surprised if this is randomly a Tempo Mage or a Mech Mage or something nonsense. It seems like Freeze Mage is the way to go here. I'm not sure if there's any delay here. We're just waiting to get into the next game. Hopefully we're starting soon.
The players look ready. Here we go. We are getting ready to start here. So we will see what Mage it is. Medivh once again. I think we're seeing all the people who bought the alternative hero portrait. So it is Freeze Mage.
It is, in fact, Freeze Mage from Zelay. So, yeah, no great surprise based on the Warrior ban. But, yeah, as you said, with the Pyroblast. Pyroblast is a card that rotated out for a while but rotated back in. And we see the Novice Engineer again, which makes me suspicious that maybe this is the Antonidas-less list. That's a word. Antonidas-less. Can we get the verdict on that? Is that a word? I don't know. Just plays double Forgotten Torch and just stacks up on natural burn in the deck. Uses the Novice Engineers to cycle through a bit faster and kind of forgoes the Antonidas portion of the game. Pretty popular list being run right now. So this could possibly be what we're looking at here. But Mad Scientist into Novice Engineer early on. You talked at length earlier about the phases of Freeze Mage early on. You're just looking to cycle through your deck, and you call it the draw phase. So Scientist, Novice Engineer, Arcane Intellect early on. Pretty solid. Picked up two secrets in his hand already, which isn't exactly ideal. But other than that, pretty nice looking hand.
The secrets in the hand, it's not great, but it's not necessarily the end of the world. Especially if your opponent floods the board early on, an early ice barrier can help if you don't pick up things like Frost Nova. And you generally want to have the second ice block in hand at some point. He's drawn it a bit early, but it's not like It's not like he absolutely doesn't want to ever play Secrets from Hand like a Hunter, for example.
Right, having the security...
Or a Mech Mage or a Temple Mage.
Sure, sure. Having the security of the Secrets from Hand is definitely a thing that you don't hate. It's just with the early Scientist draw, they're just a little bit unnecessary at this
point.
You'd rather they were other cards at this point, but you know that having that second Ice Block in hand is going to be a lot of security if the first one gets pulled off this Scientist.
It hasn't weighed down his hand too much, though, because he does have the Arcane Intellect to play here, but... I think he is looking at the secrets to see if there's a potential reason for playing barrier.
So he can force the ice block be pulled, or he can force the barrier being pulled by playing one or the other. But since he has both of the secrets in his hand anyway, it's kind of not too much of a big deal which one gets pulled in this situation. So it looks like he's just going to go ahead and out Arcane Intellect and hope he doesn't just pick up two more secrets. He did not. Okay.
He gets Blizzard. That's very important for the... for stalling out the game, and the second Doomsayer as well. So he doesn't have a Frost Nova yet, but he can double Doomsayer if he wants, which is generally a very effective way of clearing the board.
It is, but it's still relatively easily answerable on this board, and I'd be surprised to see, you know, both of your really high-value resources with the Doomsayers be thrown away so early. Forgotten Torch doesn't have a great target this turn. It's part of the great utility of Forgotten Torch that, you know, sometimes you feel like you need to kill a minion in the early game. Using Frostbolt really feels bad because you need it as an Ice Lance activator and it's just total damage gone from your deck. But Forgotten Torch is a completely different prospect because you can shoot down a minion with it in the early game and it actually just stacks more damage in your deck overall.
Yeah, it works in your favor to have done that.
Exactly.
When we first saw Forgotten Torch, that was my first opinion of it, was that it would improve Freeze Mage, if only because it added the utility of using a Frostbolt in the early game without the drawback of not having the Frostbolt later on.
Right. Does have the Dart Bomb to answer that first Doomsayer.
Yeah, unfortunate.
Zalay, though, not seeing the Owl playing. When you see a Doomsayer played in the early game like that, you're almost begging your opponent to Owl it in that situation because they're not protecting that huge of a board. And then with the Owl gone, you feel much more secure with a later gameplay of, you know, Frost Nova Doomsayer, Blizzard Doomsayer on a much larger board. But the Dart Bomb being such a clean answer there, pretty frustrating for Zalay. And he is just now going to try again with the second Doomsayer, ask for another answer. This also has the added benefit of locking out Emperor Thorasan as a play from Dog, unless he just wants to sacrifice the board and play it anyway.
So Dog can tap into second Dart Bomb, or Power of Overwhelming, or he can try and Peddler into Soulfire and Power of Overwhelming.
I don't think Power of Overwhelming would be... maybe it might. I guess if you play it on the Blood Imp, it's not too terrible. None of these are really going to get the job done, though. But yeah,
these are none of the useful things.
No, I'm sure this second Doomsayer play here from Zalay is just to prevent the on-curve Emperor Thorasan from the handlock, because turn 6 Emperor for a handlock with a handful of cards is always just such a devastating prospect. So even if this second Doomsayer did end up going down, he'd at least have to lock up some of his opponent's mana into doing that, which would still prevent the Emperor play. So. Turns out, no answer to the Doomsayer, so it probably goes a little better than expected even for Zalay. Unfortunately, he doesn't really have a powerful follow-up onto the board here. He's just drawn all his burn. But at least the Ice Barrier was activated, which means he has something to do with his hand this turn. But honestly, he might even just decide to start burning.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say. I think there's definitely a merit to playing the Barrier and the Torch, because you need to play the Torch at some point to then be able to get the Roaring Torch later on. But
yeah.
You look at the amount of damage in hand, and actually there's 19 damage in hand. There's 22 damage in hand.
Yeah.
Over the next couple of turns.
Yeah.
So you can play the Torch, and he's just going to ping instead.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to say, any turn that you... If you're doing this burn them down over several turns approach, then any ping that you work in nets you damage over the course, right? So... you know, it's a face hunter philosophy, right? Like, spend 5 mana on a 3-drop plus hero power. Don't spend 5 mana on minions. That way, you net more damage over the course of the game. So it might be he's decided that he doesn't want to go all in on the burn strategy yet, especially since he has Alexstrasza in hand. But it also might be that he's just rationing out his pings to make sure that he does maximum damage over the number of turns that are available.
Yeah, you can see it potentially does work out from here because he can he can engineer and then torch ping if he doesn't pick up something. He wants to play.
Sure.
So you can still get that torch in. Yeah, I think that's definitely the play now. And that means that you've gained 2 pings. So
Exactly.
Yeah. It does work out for him. But yeah, I definitely think it's time to start going to face here. You've got that much damage in hand. It's a little awkward because you can't. You can do Fireball Frostbolt next turn, but you can't then Pyroblast the turn after. You're one mana away.
Right. But yeah, Callum Leslie, notorious Freeze Mage player, says that it's time to go. And Zalay agrees. He's going to take the advice. We do, unfortunately for Zalay, from Dogside, see double Healbot plus Lotheb in the hand and a Farseer.
Yeah, so... I mean, that's what makes this matchup really difficult, honestly. The amount of healing in the handlock, particularly the ones that play Bran. I mean, if you've started to burn and your opponent plays Bran Healbot, you might as well concede. Because there's so little chance of you having that much damage left. But this matchup can be really good for the Freeze Mage. I mean, I wouldn't say I'm a noted Freeze Mage player, but I've probably played more Freeze Mage than I've played any other deck of meaningful standing in the community.
Okay.
You know, I've played my fair share of Secret Paladin, but Freeze Mage is probably, I would say, the deck that I have the most opinions to offer on. And this matchup can be really good just because your opponent puts themselves at a low health. The amount of times you can win this game without playing Alex is actually remarkably high, because your opponent puts themselves to under 20 health a lot of the time just by life tapping for, you know, 5 turns.
Yeah.
And then they're within range of a lot of your burn. And that's the situation that Zalay's in here. And he has a lot of the burn. He doesn't need to Alex. And actually, it does give him a decent opportunity, because if he can, it's a little awkward without the Antonitis. But if he can burn and get Dog to a point where Dog feels unsafe, he then Dog heals, and then he can Alex Strass them.
Sure. It's just a matter of how much burn he chooses to commit before that. If he gets to the point where he's gone all in on the burn strategy and Dog heals out, then even the Alex Strasser isn't going to be enough to get the work done afterwards.
It's a steering contest. Right. You have to hope that Dog blinks while you've still got enough burn to follow up with Alex and kill it.
Yeah.
But as I say, without Antonitis, that's quite difficult.
Right, I was just going to say, with both Doomsayers gone from your opponent, I feel like Iron Beak Owl for 8 damage here is pretty solid. And he is going to commit a Healbot here, so the Alexstrasza is going to get a little bit of additional value if it comes down, but he does need to react to the board this turn.
But you know Bran's there as well, so even though one Healbot is gone, the second Healbot could be really impactful. So I don't know if you want to commit to the Alexstrasza. But also, don't know what you do this turn, frankly.
There's no way you Alexstrasza this turn, because you just immediately lose your block on the backswing. So I just don't think you can commit that hard. So the board does need answering. But you see, you know, even though he got really good value out of that second Doomsayer, it wasn't really used to set up a tempo play like an Emperor onto the board or anything like that. And now, having used both Doomsayers in the early game, he sat with these Blizzards and Frost Novas in hand. And against the size of Handlock's minions, like, those cards individually don't get the job done. You need the Doomsayers to go with them. And so he just doesn't have the board clear potential now. So it's hard to see how he can engineer a position where he gets rid of this board or neutralizes this board sufficiently to be able to play Alexstrasza. The Healbot has taken away the straight burn route. So it feels like Zalay is very close to just being locked out of this game at this point.
Yeah, it is a very difficult position. As I say, the handlock match tends to go one of two ways, which is that they put themselves down so low that you burn them out before they manage to get to their healing, or they get their healing and they just negate everything that you do and you run out of steam. So those are two very common ways that the Freeze Mage handlock game can go.
Yeah, makes sense. It's surprising to me to have seen this Emperor in hand for so long for the Handlock player without it coming down onto the board. Not only is a great card in Handlock that you want to get in play as soon as possible, it's a great card against Freeze Mage, because it's one of those minions that you can't just repeatedly freeze on the board. You know, not quite to the extent of Ragnaros, but it's that same sort of thing. You can't just leave it sat there on the board the whole game. You have to deal with it, but just the way that Dog has been pressured by the burn strategy of Zalay, he's kind of been forced to heal on every turn, which has prevented his ability to play Emperor. But now, feeling secure at 24, he is just going to slam it on the board here. And it looks like this is going to be the beginning of the end for Zalay here.
Yeah, and this is where Freeze Mage does really run into difficulties, is when you don't have the mana or the time to do everything you need to do. So even just this turn, Zelay really wants to deal with the board to stop his ice block getting popped and deal with the Thorazine. But there's no way to do that. There's no way he can do that with what the resources that he has. And he doesn't have the time to draw better resources. And then if he does that and commits his burn to, you know, fireballing the Thorazine, for example, what does he then do after that?
Right. Like you said, just kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place at this point. It does come down to the usage of those Doomsayers. I definitely don't dispute his usage of them too much. Maybe the first one was a little bit ambitious, but the first one set up the second one really nicely. The problem was that the second one going off wasn't even particularly good for him in terms of the position that the game put him in. Yeah, he didn't have something to slam on the board after that. Normally, like, the concept of, like, a tempo Doomsayer, you want to develop Emperor straight afterwards. You want to develop Antonidas straight afterwards. This is probably the Antonidas-less list that we're looking at, but, you know, that theory still stands. And that second Doomsayer going off just left him with a hand where I think, like, Blizzard and a bunch of burn spells in it, so he didn't really gain too much of an advantage from the Doomsayer board clear, and now he's, like I said before, just stuck with all these freezes in hand, not answering the board.
Yeah, I can see why he went for the early Doomsayers. It does make sense in many ways, but in this situation here, where he's actually health-wise in not too bad a position, he's on 20 health, and you can generally afford to maybe get a little bit, you know, lower on the health as freeze mage. You can maybe go down to as low as 10, and then if you can stall out the board, and if you've got a Doomsayer to then clear the board, you can do that a lot better. And, you know, you can, it feels like he's maybe valued his health pool a little bit too much, and then over committed his resources to maintaining that health pool in the early game.
For sure, but this Emperor has just started to make this hand way too oppressive from Dog's side. No answer to it in the hand from Zelay. He just keeps staring at this collection of cards, just hoping that they might magically turn into something that does something here, but he finds himself in trouble. That Jiraxxus is getting cheap. The Lotheb is getting so cheap it can almost be played as an afterthought here, is it, on any turn the Dog wants to, so extremely difficult.
The turn that I was looking at is, if this Thorazine ticks another time, I mean, of course, the game is over, but the play from Dog that would be so brutal would be Jiraxxus and Lotheb.
Right.
Because then you put yourself to 15, but it's fine because you just Lotheb to keep yourself up above the life total, so.
Yeah, I mean, he's identified his only win condition here. This does potentially set up lethal on the following turn with Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance, but Dog has all the answers in the world. The block is going to go down this turn. He can play Lotheb if he wants, which means the entire turn from Zelay will have to be dedicated to playing the second ice block, and that should pretty much end the game right there.
Yeah, unfortunately for Zelay, the block is going to get popped, and as you say, the Lotheb coming down when you pop the first block is traditionally accepted as the best time to play Lotheb against freeze mages, as you pop the first ice block.
Yeah, there's only one thing better than Lotheb on the turn you pop the ice block, and that's Bran Lotheb on the turn you pop the ice block, because the game actually ends. There is nothing that a freeze mage can do in that situation. Ice Lance costs 11 mana.
He has drawn his Roaring Torch, but unfortunately, both dead.
Yeah, the game's just over. He, the one trap you can fall into in this sort of situation sometimes is overfilling your board, but he even has the Shadow Flame to blow up one of his own minions and get it out of the way if that does happen. But even that doesn't look like it's going to be a consideration here.
Yeah, I don't think that's going to be a problem. I'm just wondering if he shouldn't have healed as well, just in case.
Well, you know exactly what your opponent's turn is this turn, right? They either play Ice Block or they're dead. So you know you're not going to take additional damage this turn, so you can quite happily heal bot on the following turn. It only costs you 2 mana. It's not a huge investment at this point. So, it's basically free to do whatever he wants. He heals back up to 18 here. Maximum damage from his opponent. Actually, way... Fireball, Roaring Torch, Frostbolt, Ice Lance.
Yeah. That's a lot of damage.
It is.
That is, in fact, exactly enough, right? So is he digging for Bran right now?
He might be, yeah. Second Mortal Coil doesn't get the job done. And after extensively talking about how hopeless this game was for Zelay.
I mean, this is Freeze Mage, right? This is Freeze Mage all over.
Yeah, I mean, it was accurate for several turns. What we just didn't pick up on, because we were too busy talking about other things, was how huge that Roaring Torch draw actually was.
Yeah. And actually, what Dog needed to do there was to tap into Bran, but this combo of cards...
Wow, Zelay is actually just going to seal this out. Picks up the second Forgotten Torch as well. Wow, I did not see this one coming. I just did not pay attention at all to how important that second Roaring Torch was. I checked out of this game. That's totally my fault. I hold my hands up and apologize for this one.
Hey, I normally I would blame you, but on the one deck that I claim to be somewhat knowledgeable about, I also did it, so you know.
So yeah, Zelay, well done to him. He was sat staring at a hopeless collection of cards for a very, very long time, and although Dog looked like he had all the answers, two Healbots for 16 points of healing, no Alexstrasza being used, and having the Lotheb as well after popping the first block, like, Zelay managed to navigate his way through with a horrible collection of cards for a while, just picking up that crucial Roaring Torch that we talked about, you know, the Forgotten Torch early in the game, opening up that route for the cheap Fireball, and the cheap Fireball being what was important there, allowing the Ice Lance to be squeezed in as well, alongside the 2/6 damage burn spells.
Yeah, that was going to be my question, actually. Is there a Thorisson in that Freeze Mage build?
I don't believe so. No, I've seen it run with and without, actually.
Okay.
So.
Because the Forgotten Torch is even more relevant if you're not playing the Thorisson, because you can't discount the other Fireballs.
Right.
Dog is going to pick his Druid, and of course... It's now 1-1 in the series. Another nail biter it's going to be. But of course, this tournament is brought to you by Womble.gg, where you can play money matches against your friends and against pros in a number of esports games, and by Screenshoe.com. Dog versus LA 1-1, and it's going to be the Druid versus the Freeze Mage. I mean, the conventional wisdom is the Druid wins pretty easily, right?
Yeah. I mean, opinion varies. I think this version of the deck that plays all the burn and the Forgotten Torches and stuff is a little bit more favored on average than the classic list with all the big greedy threats. But still, opinion varies anywhere between like 65% and 80% to the Druid, depending on who's playing what. But yes, generally agreed upon, this is a pretty miserable matchup for the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, I would certainly... I think 65 is the bare minimum I would say that this matchup is for the Druid.
People tend to overstate matchups a lot, though. Like, 65% is a huge margin in Hearthstone for a deck to be favored by. So when people throw around like 70% and 80%, I don't think they, a lot of the time, have quite evaluated what that means in terms of like overall win rate. But yeah, 65 is already huge, but if there is a matchup that extends beyond that, this is definitely one of them that potentially does.
Yeah, there are very few. I mean, I don't think there are honestly any matchups that extend beyond 70% other than Control Warrior versus Freeze Mage. That would be the only one. I think
there's some Anyfin matchups that are unwinnable.
Okay.
Unlosable as the Anyfin, I should say.
Yeah. But I would say that one does stretch towards 80, but it's not 90, as some people would say. People, as you say, people tend to overstate. There's a Rich the Shredder. Yeah, exactly.
It plays it way too quickly. It doesn't even fully animate into the hand. Thankfully, we didn't encounter the glorious bug that sometimes happens with the giant card when you play it when it's top deck too quickly.
Yeah, the Mukla's Ape interaction from the tutorial of the game.
Exactly.
It's a mechanic that only exists in the tutorial fight against Mukla and when the game breaks in spectator modes.
Exactly. So he's going to coin out the Emperor here. I imagine this Acolyte probably isn't being traded into, but doing it... Yeah, okay. I was going to say, it's a really good discipline from Dog, actually, because trading into this protects the Emperor from Frostbolt and Forgotten Torch. So it's actually a pretty solid play just to protect your Emperor, get the long-term value out of it. Now it just demands a clean Fireball from the opponent if they have it.
Yeah, which Zelay does not.
No.
So...
Interesting.
There's actually no way for him to deal with this Thorisson, right? There's just literally nothing he can do.
Nope. Doesn't even have like a miserable option like Frostbolt Ice Lance. He is just straight up out of options.
Actually, look, to be fair, you can torch the Pilot Shredder and get Doomsayer.
Okay, you can Frost Nova. Yeah, okay. I was just about to say, you can Frost Nova Ice Lance Ping. That's the only way you're going to deal with it effectively. Apart from, as you said, Doomsayer. But... Yeah, that doesn't seem like a viable option. Dog is playing very, very quickly here, which is a tendency he does have in situations where he's comfortable. And a sign of this is just usually that they're evaluating their play based while their opponent is thinking on their turns, and they just come back ready with what they do. Blackout, obviously a player we're both very familiar with from the UK, is famous for the same sort of thing, playing way too fast in some situations. But he says it's just because he's already thought out every possible scenario during his opponent's turn, so he knows what's up straight away.
Whether
or not you believe that, I don't know.
I think particularly in this sort of matchup as well, I mean, you're almost playing solitaire, and you're both almost playing solitaire in this matchup.
Yeah.
It's just about winning the matchup and playing your cards in an order which gets you to win faster than your opponent, right?
Yeah.
That's, I mean, Free Speech is solitaire in so many ways.
Sure, you do have to kind of adjust your paths. I mean, Freeze Mage is an incredibly complicated flowchart, is what it is.
Yeah.
At the end of the day. So you do have to adjust your paths down that flowchart depending on what your opponent is doing, which brings it away from solitaire a little bit. But I definitely understand the analogy. Like, it is a deck where you are just achieving what you want to do and your opponent be damned, because you're just going to try and lock them out every time. Garrison Commander means that Dog can now Warrior Hero Power for 4 mana.
I have not seen a golden Garrison Commander before. He's very shiny.
He is very shiny. Speaking of shiny, a golden Dr. Boom is going to come down this turn.
You know, I crafted one of those about a month before Standard got announced, right?
Whoops.
Yep. Blizzard!
So yeah, already this game is starting to spiral out of control a little bit. We do see double Blizzard in Zalae's hand that he can use to address this board, but he doesn't have the Doomsayer to go with it. Even if he did, the Keeper of the Grove is in hand for Dog. So again, he's in a pretty sticky situation, but if we saw anything in the last game, it's that Zalae knows how to navigate his way out of sticky situations with Freeze Mage, which is one of the things you really need to be able to do with the deck. You know, anyone can pick up Freeze Mage and win the games where you just Alex on 9 and then you burn them down and everything happens wonderfully. But navigating your way through these games where everything looks a bit miserable, that's what separates the men from the boys in terms of Freeze Mage players.
Yeah, I would really say that Zalae, you know, not in terms of just decks, but in terms of playstyle, I would say he's one of the very best control players.
Mm-hmm.
That I've ever seen in tournaments. You know, I'd put him up there with you know, the likes of Life Coach, for example,
sure,
as being able to play things like Heavy Warlock, Warrior, and Freeze Mage just
right,
very effectively, and just understanding the patience and discipline and foresight required to play a control deck in that way.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a 6 damage swipe that just came into hand.
It is. It's definitely not going to get any better than that, and Swipe is not a card that you're often throwing at minions in this matchup, so...
Right. I mean, I was going to say that, you know, there is merit to just swiping face for 6. It's a fireball, right?
It's a fireball for 4 mana, exactly. So the only issue is it kind of messes up your board development a little bit, because you can't play the Druid of the Claw with it. You can play the Shade, but if a second Blizzard was to come out and you develop a Shade on this board, that's pretty devastating.
Yeah, and given 3 of your 4 minions already die to second Blizzard,
yeah,
I feel like it's a bit risky to play another minion into Blizzard. He is just going to swipe face.
Nice.
Don't mind this at all.
So he spent a lot of time counting damage that turn, which is interesting. So he does 6 with the swipe. He does an extra 2 with his face while gaining 2 armor. So he set his opponent at 16... which means if he top decks Savage Roar, he won't have the mana for the hero power, but still, he's getting his opponent nicely into that combo range.
And I don't think are there any secrets up already?
A barrier was used and dealt with. I don't believe there is a block, but again, apologies for the lack of secrets in the overlay. Hopefully we can get that addressed later on, but... that's down to the production side of things. Not a promise that I can make you guys, unfortunately, but I feel your pain. We would love to know as well, but as far as I remember...
It's not just for your benefit, it's also for our benefit and to be able to know what's happening in the game. But yes.
As far as I remember, there is not a block in play right now.
Yeah. So, I mean, the barrier is an option, the Acolyte... So you could barrier Acolyte Ping, you could also Frost Nova, or you can just do second Blizzard, but, you know, that's what you want to do. That feels pretty good. I don't know why it's, you know, Zalae's roping so much on this, but...
Yeah.
I mean, Zalae's maybe the... he does seem to play all his turn at once if he can. So I think he was more evaluating the Acolyte versus Ping after the Blizzard than the Blizzard itself, because the Blizzard was a pretty obvious play there.
For sure. And doing it that way is definitely the right way to do it. We talked about beforehand, you know, the way of you can give information to your opponent. We talked about potentially bluffing by touching cards in your hand. But if you commit one card to the board and then stop and think after that, that's so much additional information to your opponent about what your options are, what decisions exactly you're trying to make. So considering your entire turn and then playing it out afterwards is definitely the correct way to do it. So no fault to Soleil for that, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, that's... It goes back to what I was saying about the discipline and foresight of control players.
Yeah.
That's the, you know, as you say, the best way to do it. It doesn't give up what you were deciding about. So if you're playing three cards in a turn and you play two and then pause for ages and play the third, you're telling your opponent you had another option for that specific third spot rather than thinking about your whole turn.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, there's the Doomsayer. So there's Frostnova Doomsayer options.
There is, but he is in serious danger right now. He knows if there is a combo, he is in trouble, so he might be looking for some sort of option that plays around that, but this is looking dangerous. Fireball comes into hand, not a great option right now, just doesn't deal with enough of the board to be relevant, so Zalay is going to struggle through his options here, but probably do just end up with the Frostnova Doomsayer this turn, followed by Ice Barrier.
Yeah, the number one problem that he has is the lack of ice block.
Yeah.
That's really his biggest issue here. And actually, so does he's dead if he plays Barrier, right?
If he Frostnova Doomsayers and plays Barrier, he'll be at 20 with a 2-drop on the board. So no, he's fine. He should be fine.
Well, no, because there's a silence in hand. So you can silence the Doomsayer, Force of Nature, and play and hit with what's on the board.
Ah, so you're right.
14. Yeah. It'd be more than, it'd be 21. So you can it would be dead next turn.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Just like silence and get the damage in this turn to set up the combo for the following turn.
Or no, I would say silence the Doomsayer to keep your board for the following turn.
Okay. Yeah, I guess that's true. But all a formality at this point because the combo isn't in hand. But that Keeper of the Grove is going to get the work done here. Preserve this board. It didn't get addressed on the previous turn. Again, we see the correct sequencing here. Going to choose to just remove the 0-7 from the board. Although he's considering his options here, but pretty sure that's what's going to happen. Silence the Boom, and he may... I mean, is he going to decide to go face here even? Seems unlikely, but I'm just curious as to what he's considering.
Yeah, it is interesting. I mean... He's going to Wrath the Acolyte first?
Down, clears out the Acolyte of Pain, and then we are going to silence the Boom, and yes, all right, we're trading.
Okay.
Okay, good.
The actions were just queued up. There's the Ice Block, right on time.
We did it.
Because that was really what was necessary here. All the freezes were done, Doomsayers were out of the hand.
Yeah, the problem is at this point it just doesn't buy him enough turns on its own. It's come right. Too late. You know, you can play Ice Block, it immediately gets dealt with because you have no other way to realistically prevent the block being popped immediately. And you need several turns here. Yeah, there's the second one. You need
the
several
scientist
turns here.
And the second block.
You need a turn to develop your Ice Block, you need a turn to develop Alexstrasza, and then you need two more turns after that to burn your opponent down, and that's just not a realistic prospect at this point.
So can we examine the fact that he drew the Ice Block, which he needed to draw for so long, and then Arcane Intellected and got the second Ice Block, which is useless at this turn, and then, oh, you've drawn all your secrets, guess I better give you a Mad Scientist then.
Mm-hmm.
Straight after drawing the fourth secret. Great.
So I guess he took his Doomsayer out there. Didn't get it. Block is going to come down to prevent the lethal, but this should be a game. And I'm worried about how badly burned we got last time, but this should be a game that is more or less a formality from this point.
Yeah, when you can Force of Nature this turn to hit the block in a pretty efficient way. You don't even need to. You can also Hero Power, just if you want.
Yep, no reason not to Hero Power here. Stacks you up the extra armor as well. Just to give you that extra insurance.
I miscalculated by one. Okay. What was on the boards.
But yeah, just not enough turns here. He drew into the ice block, but they came down way too late, which means the turns are not... Yeah, okay.
Wow.
Zalae's deck just decides to troll him. Zalae's going to go ahead and concede. Recognizes that the second ice block is not going to get the job done here.
That's pretty troll. You draw your third and fourth secrets you've been trying to draw all game and instantly draw both mad scientists.
Yep.
I mean, the mad scientists are crucial. You know, I talked about the draw phase earlier on, and the mad scientists do count as draw in this deck. Because not only are you pulling the cards that you want, like the ice block, you do need to equip the ice block and you want the barrier to help deal with all your pressure. It also thins your deck to be able to make your draws more efficient from your other draw mechanisms.
Yep.
So Zalae's moving on to the Warlock, of course. That is his only deck left. Dog up 2-1 here. And yeah, this is looking like a strong performance for both of these players. But unfortunately, the Druid just too strong for the Freeze Mage. I would expect some kind of control Warlock from Zalae.
Yeah, like Absolutely. You said, primarily known as a control player. Have seen him play aggro when it's necessary. You know, he does also like winning, so he's going to bring the aggressive lineup when it's necessary. But is primarily known as a control player. But yeah, as we see, this is in fact a Zoo. So he has a nice lineup here against the Druid. Picks up the Zoo, very favorable matchup. Double Knife Juggler in hand, very aggressive start into the Imp Gang boss. One of the strongest openings against Druid, unless you have a really solid opening with Death Rattle minions into buffs. So
this would be... So Zalae has to beat the Druid and the Rogue.
Yes.
With the Zoo.
Yeah.
What's the Rogue-Zoo matchup like, very quickly?
Depends on the Rogue, but assuming it's just a standard Oil Rogue, it's a little bit Rogue-favored. An experienced Rogue player would probably consider themselves reasonably advantaged in that matchup. But again, it also depends on tech cards in the Zoo list, whether it's the Sea Giant build, you know, Leeroy Power Overwhelming build, Doomguard build. There's a bunch of ways to build Zoo now that, like, just saying Zoo isn't descriptive enough, honestly.
Right.
But the Rogue will probably feel happy queuing into a Zoo most of the time.
This is interesting. The Living Roots on turn one, we talked about Living Roots early on, that's a great card to have on turn one, but it is really great to have on turn one against Zoo, even if you're going first, because you can do this and then say, well, you know, you want to coin out your Knife Juggler? Okay, sure, if you want. But then it just dies to the adorable little trees.
Right. The counter is Voidwalker. That's the nightmare that you don't want to run into, especially when you have Wild Growth in your hand, because you don't want to spend your turn two hero powering down that last point of health. But in this situation, it's pretty effective at locking out Zalae's hand here. And Living Roots into Wild Growth is one of the dream openings, especially if it's not answered by that Voidwalker that we talked about. So.
So he's going to coin out the Imp Gang boss. Didn't even opt to coin the Dark Peddler last turn, even to maybe deal with these 1-1s and get another 1-1. But yeah, just going for the Imp Gang boss. No 4-drop for Dog.
No.
So I guess he's just thinking Hero Power Face.
Yeah, and I like this line from Zalae. No reason to sacrifice a Dark Peddler into these 1-1s because he has a very beneficial card to play into it on the following turn anyway. The 1-1s are actually of benefit to this Imp Gang boss being in play, so... No reason just to let them trade off into a Dark Peddler if he can get away with it. And now he has all these extra resources still in hand to go along with those Knife Jugglers in following turns. Just be able to fill the board up at any point that he wants.
And just a big game Hunter coming out from Dog. I think that's pretty okay. I mean, you do get punished later on, potentially, if it's a Demon Zoo. But you get something on the board and you do directly challenge the Imp Gang boss.
Yeah, and for sure, the most common form of Zoo is topping out at Doomguard and Lurtheb at this point. You do arguably see Sea Giants more than you used to a couple of weeks ago, but the threat of the Demon Zoo has all but gone away at this point, I feel like. So if you're holding on to a Big Game Hunter, you're probably way more worried about the threat of a Sea Giant than you are about the threat of maybe Mal'Ganis or Dr. Boom, for example.
And Demon Zoo is one of those decks that's still... It's not necessarily a bad deck. It's still a decent deck. It's in the same spot as Handlock, and it's just been surpassed by other decks in the same bracket. But, I mean, players still might want to play it. And we see that with Demon Handlock here, that people who want to play it can still play it and do well with it. But we see another player using Gormok here in the Zoo. So this is a kind of more traditional board flood Zoo.
Yeah, it looks. I mean, previously you'd only really see Gormok in the kind of all-in flooding list that first 6.0 and then Reynad popularized with different versions.
I was going to say, it's a Reynad original zoo. It's just all about the board flood.
Originally, Gormok you only saw in that list with, you know, all the echoing uses and stuff, but people quickly realized that it's just a really strong card, even just a really standard list, because of, you know, you have Creepers, Implosion, Imgang Boss, etc. There's a lot of great options to just flood the board with Gormok, and it's kind of in that Dark Iron Dwarf slot where it's not as consistent in its usage as Dark Iron Dwarf, but the effect is so much more powerful.
Yeah, it can be a really powerful card, and just such a swingy card. Some people, I think, originally looked at it as a win more card, that it didn't necessarily give you enough in terms of tempo swing or momentum in a meaningful spot, but I think that was that's been disproved now. So we see he picks up the Flaming Puff, the Discover. Sorry, we don't have the other perspective to show you the Discover. But we get there in the end. We see what he gets. And Flame Up's a decent pickup off Discover. Especially in Zoo, it's pretty good. It's not the best, but you can't be too unhappy about it, right?
No. Flame Imp is definitely a solid pickup, especially against Druid, where Flame Imps just represent so much aggression every time you drop one on the board. And yeah, looks like this is the one dwarf, one Gormok list from Zalay. Dogside chose to go with the Force of Nature there instead of just dropping Emperor, primarily out of respect for things like Gormok the Impaler, Power Overwhelming, that would have been just so devastating in tempo there. He had a 1-1 on the board, so Gormok coming down or PO coming down would have just smashed that Emperor off the board and put the Zoo deck in a position that was just way too hard to come back from. But still, similar position has developed here. The Argus play still hits two minions, develops a big board here. And he can choose to activate a Gormok here, but not too much value in it overall. The Implosion or Dark Iron Dwarf is probably more favorable. But having not seen a swipe yet, we talked about it at some length in the previous games of this matchup. You generally, as the Zoo player, don't really want to swipe don't want to Implosion until you see a swipe come out from your opponent. So it seems like the Dark Iron Dwarf would be the cleanest play if he wants to trade, but he may also decide with these two Argus Taunts up right now that it's just time to go in and put the Druid on a race situation.
Yeah, absolutely. There's some good options for the Zoo here, and I just say it is about how you decide you want to play it from this point forward and whether or not you want to really flip the switch and be more aggressive. But he's going to go for the trade. What do you think of trading the Imp Gang Boss rather than the Flame Imp?
I mean, I think that's correct. It represents the maximum power on the board afterwards. You trade a 3-power minion off instead of a 4-power minion, and it also gets replaced by that additional 1-1. So this seems like the right line to me for sure. But now he is forced into this Emperor play that was he would have been worried about previously was so devastating, but honestly, he feels like if any of those cards he was worried about before, say, you know, Gormok the Impaler and Power Overwhelming, at this point, if those cards are in your opponent's hand, you've probably just lost the game anyway. So you might as well just hope that they don't have it and just take the risk of getting the Emperor in play. But Gormok is going to come down here, do his work. 1-1 gets the trade in.
The comically giant animation of Gormok's damage. It really is. Like, comparing it to, like, Knife Juggler and Fan of Knives.
Yeah.
He's ridiculously huge. I must
safeguard them. It is. Druid of the Claw now comes down, Keeper of the Grove, to silence the egg, try and reduce that value, but that is just gonna be GG with the owl.
Yep, so Zalay's gonna level this series up, our third series of the day that's gonna go to all five games. Forget what I said about last year we're standing in one-sided games. Never happens. This is what happens. Series.
Every single series, I believe, has gone at least 3-1. I think the Ryzen series was 3-1 and all the rest have been 3-2 so far. Is that correct?
Yeah, so this is the third one that's 3-2 and there was one that was 3-1.
Yeah, I mean, that, as I mentioned, that is very often how you build a Last Hero Standing lineup. If you play Last Hero Standing 100 times and win every series 3-2, you'll go away with that thinking, you know, my lineup was pretty solid, because that's kind of how the format works. But on top of that, we did talk about the possibility of blowouts from power decks in the meta, but as we discussed as well, it's just not the case right now. There's strong decks that people worry about, you know, Druid, Secret Paladin, etc., but they're not on that broken level that Warsong Patron was, that Miracle Rogue was. These things that we saw 3-0-ing so commonly in Last Hero Standing before.
if Last Hero Standing had been had been popular during the height of Warsong Patron,
right, yeah.
I think people, I honestly don't think we would be doing Last Hero Standing now.
No.
Because Last Hero Standing would have been as awful as it was back when Druid and, you know, from Undertaker Hunter and Miracle Rogue. I mean, that was the World Championships in 2014.
Yeah.
Was, you know, it was just before that they nerfed Undertaker.
Yeah.
So yeah, it was up until that point, things were getting pretty nasty with, let's say, Miracle Rogue, Undertaker Hunter, and Druid. How things change.
Yeah, how things change. The one constant in all these formulas just to be Druid. So, I don't know. Maybe that'll come to an end soon. I'm not sure.
Yep, well here we go. The fifth game of the series. And we just see a Bran in the zoo, which we didn't see before.
Mm-hmm.
Bran is pretty good in zoo, actually. I mean, a 2-4 for 3 mana is a good stat line. Being able to have double Dark Peddler, double... What other battle cries are on the deck? I mean, there's Gormok.
There's Gormok, Argus, Abusive Sergeant, Dark Iron Dwarf. There's a ton of battle cries in there.
Flamen, but that one's not...
Yeah, nice. Exactly. You have to avoid the negative synergies occasionally, but usually your Bran doesn't stick around on the board too long for that to come up to be a problem. He has got the Rogue into Zoo matchup. Yeah, slight favourite for the Rogue, in my opinion. And Deadly Poison and SI7 in the opening hand is definitely to his benefit. But the thing that works against him here is this is a Miracle Rogue list. We see the Gadgetzan Auctioneer in hand as the draw engine as opposed to the sprint. And the problem with Miracle Rogue is that it's just that little bit slower than the standard Oil Rogue, which is a fact that Zoo can take advantage of and punish.
Does it also have... How does it compare in terms of removal resources to an Oil Rogue?
It's pretty similar. It plays mostly all of the same stuff. The difference is you don't have as many activators for your Blade Flurry because the oils are gone. So you're just kind of down to the Deadly Poison and the spell power in terms of being able to activate those properly. But this start here picks up the backstab perfectly on curve with the SI7 agent and gets to curve out here nicely, gets ahead on the board by that one minion. And this might just come down to an implosion roll.
Well, sure. It depends how confident you're feeling in your RNG, I think, if you're Zalay. Do you feel like it's going to be two because you need it to be anything else?
It's possible. You do have the option of just playing Dark Peddler and Soulfire. You can also discard the coin in that scenario, which would be pretty excellent. But the coin implosion, 66% of the time, is a pretty strong play here.
That's a good percentage, but this is Hearthstone, so is it really 66%? Depends who's playing, I think.
Are you trying to suggest some sort of behind the scenes conspiracy here, Callum?
No, it's all a mental thing. It's how good do you think your RNG is? I mean, we were talking about this earlier on. He gets the three.
Okay, so yeah, pretty reasonable scenario. But the Violet Teacher is able to follow up again. Power Overwhelming will be the thing that he's scared of in this situation, but he's curving out really, really nicely here. He got the early tempo removal to stabilize the board against the 1-drops and 2-drops of Zoo, and now he's just curving out into minion after minion that can contest the board. So in terms of Miracle Rogue being a little bit slower, this is a nice curve, a good draw from Rogue, so he'll be feeling pretty confident about his chances here, I think.
Yeah, I mean, looking at that curve, you've got Azure Drake into either Thorazon or Gadgetzan, whichever you want to do. Probably the Thorazon if you don't pick up at the spells that you would need for the Gadgetzan. Oh, Bran just coming down for tempo as well as the Soulfire. And what did he discard there? Sorry, I didn't quite...
He discarded the Defender of Argus.
Yeah.
Which is a pretty nice card to have against Rogue. It does, you can, you know, set up your board in ways that protects from removal from your opponent by using Argus. It also just pushes a lot more damage to consolidate your board. And it would have been nice with that Bran in hand that there's actually no way to kill right now, but I guess most importantly, he holds onto his Doomguard here.
The prep is a really nice pickup with the Gadgetzan. If that's what he does want to do, you know, if he could pick up something like an Eviscerate and be able to prep that, the Gadgetzan could go off next turn.
Yeah, he might decide to go the Emperor route, though, because if he Emperors on 6, he can Auctioneer on 7 for 5 mana, plus the Dagger Up, plus the 0 mana Deadly Poison, and then still have that prep to play another spell afterwards. So it's a much longer draw chain if you wait that one additional turn, but honestly, it's going to come down to how much time he feels he has in the matchup based on the outcome of this play here from the Double Peddler.
Right, and as we've discussed before, Dog is a very experienced rogue player. He knows this matchup. He knows this deck very well, and he will know, I would think, exactly how much time he has and how much room he can give himself.
Right. Unfortunately, we're not getting to see the discover choices here. Corruption is the first choice, gets the second choice now from the Bran activation.
So Soulfire and Corruption so far from Peddlers.
Yeah.
And Tournament Attendee, not the greatest Dark Peddlers.
No. Is just going to corrupt that Azidrake since he has no way of dealing with it right now and it is such a problematic minion. But now, if he wants to play the Emperor here on curve, that Tournament Attendee does prevent him from destroying the Bran. So the Violet Teacher is a massive pickup there, actually. Just being able to fill out the curve, get the hero power, get rid of the Bran. And he's looking in a pretty nice position.
Yeah, well, he does give himself that he gives himself that extra turn, I think, to make the decision as well on Thorisson and Gadgetzan.
Yeah.
By playing that Violet Teacher, he can also just use his spells to make his Violet Teacher go off. If the Power Overwhelming hadn't happened, of course, the Teacher and Gadgetzan combination could have been very old school devastating.
So he's going to owl his PO'd imp here just to retain the 1-1 on the board. Guess he just imagines that owl is not going to be useful in future, just wants to use it to load up power here, represent the threat of that Doomguard on the following turn to push through a ton of damage. No Blade Flurry drawn as of yet, so Dog is going to have to decide whether he needs to go off right now with that Auctioneer or whether he can afford to wait one turn, and it looks like he's of the opinion that he can wait. So he's going to load up that Emperor, discount his hand, and next turn, as I said, he can now Gadgetzan for 5 mana, has that spare mana to dagger up, and then he can play the Deadly Poison and the Abyss and still have that prep for an additional spell that he draws.
Yeah, this could be, as you say, a very big draw train coming off this Gadgetzan. I think Doug's signaling to us that that's what he's looking to play, but going all in here is Alay. He's trying to think what to do about this Thorisson.
Yeah, so he can get another juggle if he wants to trade with the Imp Gang boss here, which can potentially set things up. But he's just debating whether he wants to get that 5 damage to go face, also whether he wants to lower the health on his Doomguard, because right now having that one big high health guy on the board plays around Blade Flurry a little bit. So yeah, I like him preserving the health on his Doomguard, pushes the most damage, and makes the defensive play against Blade Flurry by having that 7 health in play on the Doomguard.
So I think you have to go off at this point and hope you get the right cards, right?
Yeah. Dog disagrees, but I would have liked to see the dig for Flurry this turn. He can Gadgetzan, Hero Power, Deadly Poison, Eviscerate. That's 2 draws for Flurry. Then he can prep. That's 3 draws for Flurry. And then after that, yeah, so he would have 3 total draws to hit 2 copies of Blade Flurry from his deck, which would be a complete ball clear.
Yeah, and if he can't do that, so he can Deadly Poison 1, Deadly Poison and Eviscerate the 2 health minions, which would leave 6. He would take potentially 2 damage to face. So that Earthen Ring Farseer does perhaps change things. He wants to play that, so he plays the Pillager as well. Mm. And I mean, it does give him another option for his Gadgetzan later on with the coin from the Tomb Pillager.
Sure. But yeah. Dog choosing not to trust his deck there. He would have definitely had to commit. That is actually just lethal.
Wow.
Doomguard for exact lethal off the top. The turn that Dog turned down, he would have had to commit. He would have had to eviscerate the 5-7, for example, to hope that he drew the Blade Flurry if he didn't draw it immediately off the Deadly Poison. So I guess that sort of ambiguity, that unknown factor of you know, having to make a weak play if he didn't draw Blade Flurry, just left him hoping that he could pick up that one more turn, but the Doomguard came down and crushed his dreams there.
Absolutely. So 0-2 for Liquid in this tournament, unfortunately. We're not going to be seeing any of them in the round of 8, both Sho and Dog losing in the round of 16, but for Archon, Zali moving forward. So congratulations to him. Another very close series. The Doomguard top deck, the second Doomguard in 2 turns. So 2 Doomguards out of 3 draws, was that?
I think there was a gap in the, because he had the turn where he had the Doomguard in his hand and the Soulfire didn't discard it, and then he played the Doomguard the turn after.
Oh, right, yeah. The second Doomguard had been there for a while, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, the Doomguard top deck, pretty harsh, but Zali is going to advance to our top 8. And see, he will face the winner of Hoi versus Jab. We're going to have that game coming up in just a little while. We're going to go back now and catch that Orange versus Strifeco game, NA versus EU, decide who will face Ryzen in tomorrow's top eight. We're going to go to a very short break while we get these players ready, but it will be a short one. Remember, this is the Wombology tournament brought to you by Wombo.gg. We can play money matches against your friends and against pros in a number of esports games, and by screenshoe.com. Don't go anywhere, you're watching the Wombology tournament. We'll be back in just a minute.